You were tested as a child with the hardship of a trial. When you traveled to Medina with the death of your mother Amina. Ya Nabi Salam Alayka, Ya Rasul Salam Alayka, Ya Habib Salam Alayka, Salawatullah Alayka. At the age 12 it was related, under the cloud you remain shaded. Noticed by the monk Bahira, you showed your seal to his basira. Ya Nabi Salam Alayka, Ya Rasul Salam Alayka, Ya Habib Salam Alayka, Salawatullah Alayka. The most handsome ever created, the most trustworthy when he traded. Greatest love story written on pages is with you and Khadij and Ben Quaided. Ya Nabi Salam Alayka, Ya Rasul Salam Alayka, Ya Habib Salam Alayka, Salawatullah alayka. In seclusion on the mountain of light, the angels with you tied and commanded you to recite the Quran that hints your life. Ya Nabi Salam alayka, Ya Rasul Salam alayka, Ya Habib Salam alayka, Salawatullah alayka. Through your trials and tribulations, persecution and humiliation, you were steadfast and always patient, sent as mercy to all creation. Ya Nabi Salam Alayka, Ya Rasul Salam Alayka, Ya Habib Salam Alayka, Salawatullah Alayka. We come here in the name of Allah, with the blessings of Imam Hiyal Sheikh Yahya. They revive your blessed sunnah, they're both models for your ummah. Ya Nabi Salam Alayka, Ya Rasul Salam Alayka, Ya Habib Salam Alayka, Salawatullah Alayka.
Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wa ala. Allahumma salli wa sallam ala sayyidina Muhammadin iftahi bab rahmatillah. Adil ma fi ilmillah, salatun wa salam da'imin wa bidu'ami mulkillah. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wa ala. Wa shar'u annahu allahu alladhi la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah. Wa shar'u anna sayyidina Muhammadin abduhu wa rasuluh. Amma ba'd, alhamdulillah. This is a great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be here with you all in this very lovely place of worship, a masjid, literally the ism al makan, the place of sujood. وَأَكَرُ مَا يَكُونَ الْعَبْدِ إِلَى رَبِّهِ وَهُوَ سَاجِدٍ. And the closest that a servant is to his Lord is while he is prostrating. These are places where these meanings of lowliness and humility and absolute need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are engendered or cultivated and absorbed into the heart of the believers. That these are places that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us is that if someone's heart is attached to the mosque, is that they'll be from the seven categories of people that are under the shade of the throne of Allah, the day in which there is no shade except His shade, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that, mashallah, as we approached and the light that is in these young, beautiful children as they're playing outside, that alhamdulillah, this is a wonderful way to enter, and as we come into these sacred spaces, that these are ultimate opportunities to cultivate that meanings of this deen that are not cultivated in any other way, in any other place. This is why that we have to have our hearts attached to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which becomes a house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that when the intention is made to set it over and turn it into a house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this shows us the power of intention. And that with all of the various conditions, according to the different scholars, that need to be in place in order to make it a house of Allah ta'ala, but when it's actually very simple, is that when the intention is made, when all those conditions are fulfilled, of course, and it becomes a house of Allah, that simply by that idafa, that affiliation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that space that was that space is no longer the space that it was before, and it's now changed. Now that it has a special concern, a special divine concern from our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that which happens therein is not like what happens that just outside the door when we walk out. And that one of the great proofs of this is that the Prophet himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was built on a graveyard, abandoned graveyard of the mushrikeen. That there were polytheists that were actually buried there. And they then exhumed many of their bodies and moved them aside. And the Prophet built his mosque on that part of that place. And that the place where the Prophet is buried is the purest place in the universe. And so that it went from a graveyard of people who associated partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to a place that was known as now as Tayyibah. And that there's some that included after that the adjective describing Medina the radiant, Medina and Murawara. In other words, to teach us in our deen that our deen is not only pure in and of itself, is that the deen will purify people. That our Prophet ﷺ is pure and purifying. That the teachings of Islam are pure in and of themselves, unadulterated, absolutely, completely from Rabbil Alameen, from the Lord of the world subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they will purify you, that if you open up your heart to them. And this is one of the fundamental duties of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that along with reciting to us the signs of God, teaching us the Quran, teaching us the wisdom, his sunnah, but also purifying us. This is one of the fundamental jobs and duties of our Prophet, is that there be tazkiyah, where he said kinhi, and that he also purifies them. In other words, is that our Prophet's teachings, that just even reading about him, anything associated with the Prophet, will always be that of the most purest type and of the most purest form. And so it is these places in which that we congregate to really take on an affair which is the most important of all affairs. And that we are very, very happy to be here with our dear friend. Like I say dear friend, because there's certain people that you meet that it's almost as if you've known them from the day of Alastu Bi Rabbikum. And that when you meet someone as special as that your Imam here, Imam Mikael, is that, mashallah, that you all better take good care of him or we're going to take him from you and bring him up to Pennsylvania. That's the right response. That you all have a true jewel that is amongst you here, that Allah Ta'ala has blessed with great purity, and that when the hearts meet, when there is purity, that wonderful things happen, and a deep love ensues, and so that this is someone that we feel like we've known for a very long time. We met him at the first time at the retreat over the summer, and then Allah brought us together at Hajj as well. May Allah Ta'ala accept from all of us. And so it's wonderful here to now come visit his community, and that many people that we've seen outside of your home community and other places to come where you all from, that this is a great blessing. And that this is a great topic. And that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to assist us in this affair. Because that the book at hand is a book that is very serious. And our deen is a very serious deen. And that the way that we approach the affairs of the deen should be with the utmost seriousness. As the great Tabi'een, one of the followers, the generation right after the Sahaba said, he says, "Inna hadha al-amr deen." Right? This affair, this matter is one of religion. It's deen. فَانْظُرُوا عَمَّا تَأْخُذُونَ. So look then that who you take this from. This is an affair of deen, so look to you who you take it from. And if we just understand this very simply, is that like anything else in the world, if there's something that's important to you, that if you have to get a major surgery and you've been diagnosed with cancer or you've been diagnosed with a serious problem, is that you are going to get a second opinion. And you are going to do your research. You are going to look at reviews for the physician that you're going to, that you might even travel that across the United States to go to a clinic that you know is especially good for treating cancer or whatever illness that you might have. And this is your worldly life. If you lose it, it's not really that big a deal. You're going to die one day or another. In a sense, if you cure yourself, you're just prolonging that a few more moments that you have as long as you're here. That you're going to die eventually. We're all going to die eventually. But it's always amazing to me how people, what they'll do for their worldly life. But when it comes to Deen, subhanAllah, is that we have a level of knowledge oftentimes in our communities that is unacceptable, because we live in a time where a Sunday school approach, although there should be Sunday schools, but a Sunday school approach is not necessarily going to give the tools, and it's not going to give our children the tools that they need, right, to be able to that understand their deen in light of the onslaught of their deen in the modern world, especially in the United States of America, is that we need to equip them with the sophisticated nature of our tradition, inwardly, outwardly, intellectually, and spiritually, connect them with an unbroken chain back to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and such that the light of that tradition can flow within them, and then outwardly, is that they can critically analyze everything, ideally from a perspective that is rooted in the worldview of Islam, for lack of a better word. In other words, is that we have great challenges that are before us, and that we need to reflect upon ourselves. And that, to what degree do we take this deen seriously? To what degree are we willing to sacrifice for the sake of this deen? And that sacrifice is really something that sums up the life of Sadat and the Sahaba. They were willing to sacrifice anything for the sake of the deen. And Imam Jabir, Sayyidina Jabir ibn Abdullah, one of the seven Mukthirin min al-Riwayah, one of the great Sahaba, one of the seven companions, or known as the Mukthirin, who narrate a lot, quote, of hadith. And that he was the first one to establish the sunnah. And our Prophet ﷺ said, "Man sanna sunnatan hasanatan," this is in Sahih Muslim, that whoever initiates a good practice, a good sunnah, and that he will have the reward of all of those who follow that same sunnah without it diminishing his reward in any way. He's the one that first initiated the sunnah practice of traveling to a distant place for one hadith. And that he had heard that there was a hadith that was narrated about the matter of the end of time or of the afterlife, and he traveled that a long distance just to meet the companion who had heard that from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And thus it became a sunnah after that, is that where scholars would travel distances, and oftentimes that even if they already knew the hadith, but they wanted the hadith with a shorter chain, and that they would do this. And this was just an example of how serious that they took their deen. And that
Imam Ghazali gives a beautiful example. We all understand love, being in love, falling in love. He always brings it back and touches the heart. Imam Ghazali says, "Such a man does not detest death and meeting Allah, but only fears the meeting of Allah passing him by as a result of his deficiency and remissiveness. He is like a man who is made late for a meeting with his beloved. Brother has a date with his wife for his 16th anniversary. And he's getting busy, he's getting ready. And he's not ready yet. So he's getting later and later and later. But he's not getting later. She says, "Are you coming?" "I'm coming, but I'm not ready yet." What's delaying him? His love for her is delaying him. Brothers, you can use this to show. "My love for you is delaying me." I can't use it now because I just used it. Allahu Akbar. Imam Ghazali says this second individual who's doing Tawbah, this person is like that person in love who's getting late because he's getting ready. "And I'm not ready yet. This doesn't look good. No, this." She stands in front of the mirror. "No, this isn't. I'm changing. It's time to go. No, I gotta look perfect." This is the person in his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah give us that type of relationship with him. May Allah give us that level. Such a beautiful level to, "I'm not ready for salah yet. I'm not ready for salah yet. I'm not ready to stand before Allah yet. Let me do my miswak now. Let me do this again." May Allah give us that, inshallah. So he says, he is not deemed, going on to page 8, he is not deemed to be reluctant of the meeting. But don't claim love. Brothers, don't claim love. Imam Ghazali, see, people don't like Imam Ghazali because he's real. He talks to your heart. He leaves no room for you to go here and there. Right after showing you the sign of a lover, he tells you the distinguishing mark so you can know if you really are that one. He says the distinguishing mark of the penitent man is that it is his constant preparation for this matter and his lack of any other concern. So were you constantly preparing to meet Allah? Were you constantly in this worry? Were you constantly after it? That's the distinguishing mark. That's the sign. Were he to be otherwise, he would associate this man with the engrossed of the world. He says, if you're not busy with this meeting Allah, and you claim to not be ready to meet Allah, then you're with the first man. You're with the first man. Walk the way you talk. That's what he's saying. As for the Gnostic, the one who's the Arif Billah, the one who knows Allah, he's constantly looking forward to meeting Allah, and we'll see some examples momentarily. He remembers death constantly, because for him, it is the chance to meet his beloved. He doesn't want to get ready. I'm ready now. I just want to go meet him. I just want to go meet her, because I'm in too much love now. It doesn't matter anymore. Let me just go. That's the second, that's the third person. Usually such a man considers death slow in coming. It's taking too long. We've been engaged too long. I can't take this anymore. It's going to kill me. His death is the engagement. His death is the nikah. And he's waiting for the day of the nikah. When will it come? When will it come? And 2 more months, 3 more months. My grandmother from Afghanistan is coming. You know what I'm talking about. We all go through it. 5 more months. No, he wants that death now, because the death is his meeting his beloved. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, sallu ala Habib. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Then he says in the next paragraph, thus it is that the penitent man may be excused for the aversion he feels for death. The one who's doing tawbah, we excuse him. We excuse him. While another is excusable in loving it and longing for it. And higher than either of these two degrees, as Sidi Yahya has explained to us, is the one who has given over his affair to Allah. He took the ana out of everything. He took the me out of everything. He took what I want out of it. And he said, Allah, what you want is what I want. Your rida is my rida. And this is the highest level. May Allah give us this, inshaAllah ta'ala. In the last paragraph, Imam Ghazali says, whatever it may be, whatever stage you may be at, whatever it is, the remembrance of death, of maut, the remembrance of this is beneficial for you. And it is meritorious in itself. There is merit in it, in and of itself. This is an act that is not husn li ghayrihi. It is not husn, beautiful, because it leads to something else. The remembrance of death is something which is husn li dhatihi. It is in itself something which is an objective of deen. We have to remember that before we go forward.